I'm happy that we have this opportunity again to study God's Word together. We studied last night how the devil is planning to take over the entire world, and his plans are well underway. I showed you how that the move to exalt the Virgin Mary as a co-redeemer, as a mediator, and as a divine helper is not only something that is changing the Roman Catholic Church and revitalizing the Roman Catholic Church, but it is a movement that is also having a tremendous impact on the Muslim world, and those are the two biggest religions in the world, the Roman Catholic religion and the Muslim religion. But not only that, it is sweeping Buddhism, Hinduism, and people in the New Age movement, people that aren't religious at all. I need somebody to start this timer for me, please. How successful could the devil be with this movement? My dear friend, if there's anything that I can do this evening, I want to shake you loose from any self-confidence that you have. I don't want you to feel that you can escape, because I'm going to read to you right now from the Spirit of Prophecy that you will not escape unless God specially intervenes. We should at all times feel our constant dependence on His divine power to keep us from being taken in by the devil's deceptions. Let me just read this to you from the book Great Controversy, page 534. Wait till the cell phone is turned off, thanks. It says, Satan himself is the enemy who tempts man to sin and then destroys him if he can, and when he has made sure of his victim, then he exalts in the ruin he has wrought. If permitted, he would sweep the entire race into his net. Were it not for the interposition of divine power, not one son or daughter of Adam would escape. If God didn't intervene, how many human beings would escape the devil's deception? How many? Not one. Not one man, not one woman. We are vulnerable unless the Lord intervenes. I remember, this is an awful story, but help you to understand what we're talking about, of a young Seventh-day Adventist lady who was on a bus. This happened many years ago already. And the person that was sitting her, the man that was sitting her next on the bus was a psychologist. And he was also a hypnotist. Of course, psychology is one of those areas of science where they have gotten into the study of hypnotism. And she said rather nonchalantly to him, well, you can never hypnotize me. That bus broke down. She came to in a hotel room with this man, ready to get in bed with him. What caused her to come out of the hypnotic trance was that she had developed a lifelong habit of, just before she went to bed, of studying her Sabbath school lesson. And when she reached in and got from her things the Sabbath school quarterly and began to study the Sabbath school lesson, instantly the Lord brought her out of that trance. And he confessed that, yes, he had hypnotized her. The devil is able to take control in one way or another of any human mind unless the Lord intervenes. Now, there's only one way that you and I are going to escape being deluded by these last day deceptions that are abroad today. And that's if the Lord intervenes. But how is the Lord going to intervene? What is the Lord going to do to keep you from being taken in by the devil's deceptions? Well, let's read a few Bible texts. What the Lord knew a long time ago, the deceptions that we were going to have to face in the last days. And the Lord has given special promises, therefore, to people that live in the last days. Here's one, Malachi 4, right at the end of the Old Testament. It says, "Behold, I am sending to you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and terrible," or great and awesome, "day of the Lord," day of Jehovah. "And he shall turn the hearts of the fathers unto the sons, and the hearts of the sons unto the fathers, lest I come and strike the earth with a curse." Notice the Lord promises that in the last days, just before the second coming of Christ, the great and terrible day of the Lord is not the first coming of Christ, that's the second coming of Christ. And just before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord says, "I'm going to send to you Elijah the prophet." Remember, Elijah did not write any books of the Bible. He did not come to the children of Israel to give them any new instruction or light. He came as a Reformation prophet to bring them back to the truth that they had wandered away from. A Reformation prophet is a prophet that brings you back to Bible truth. Now, we could read many texts showing that in the last days, God is going to give an Elijah prophet, God is going to give the gift of prophecy to his people. Paul promises us very clearly in his epistles that the people that are living in the last days, just before the second coming of Christ, are going to have the gift of prophecy. You can read it in 1 Corinthians 1, verses 4 to 8, or you can read it in Ephesians 4, verses 1 to 16. Perhaps the best known scriptures in this regard are Revelation 12, 17 and Revelation 19, 10, where the scripture says, talking about the last days, that the dragon, that's the devil, was angry with the woman, that's the church, and went to make war with the remnant, that's the last, the remaining ones of her seed, her descendants, who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Notice two specifications are pointed out. God's people in the last days are going to be commandment keepers. They could not be called commandment keepers, by the way, if they broke one. Because if you keep the whole law and break one, you're a breaker of the law. It's not 10 laws, it's just one law. Any part you break, you're a lawbreaker. The 10 commandments are not 10 laws, they are one law. And secondly, God's people in the last days will have the testimony of Jesus. And Revelation 19:10 says that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Some years ago, there was a radio program in Australia. They received a communication. This communication was an anonymous communication. It claimed to be from a man who was a member of the Society of Jesus, that is, the Jesuit order of the Roman Catholic Church. This man said that he was a teacher in a school in the British Isles. He was a teacher, not in a Catholic school, a teacher in a Protestant school. He mentioned that in this communication, he said that there is a church mentioned in Revelation 12, 17 and 19, 10, and he said, "We have thoroughly infiltrated that church." Now, there are many scriptures that show that God's people will have the gift of prophecy in the last days. Another one is Joel, the second chapter. Notice the warning of Jesus in regard to prophets here in Matthew 24. Matthew 24 and verse 24. "For they shall arise," that is, the subject now is false Christs and false prophets, "and they will show great signs and wonders so as to deceive, if possible, even the elect." Now notice, Jesus doesn't warn us against all prophets in the last days. He only warns us against false prophets in the last days. If there were to be no prophets in the last days, it would have been easy for the Lord to just say, "Well, don't believe any prophet that comes to you in the last days." But he didn't say that. He's warned us not against prophets in general, but against false prophets. So we need to know how, from the Bible, how to test a prophet to find out whether they are true or false. I'll review with you very quickly in the next 3 or 4 minutes the Bible tests for a true prophet. Number one, Numbers 12:6, the Lord said, "If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will manifest myself to him in a vision and in a dream." And the Bible specifies clearly what happens to a prophet who is having a vision. You can read it in Daniel, the 10th chapter. You can also read a little bit about it in Numbers 20, 23 and 24, the experience of Balaam, where he had his eyes open when he had a vision. And in the book of Daniel, it specifies clearly that a prophet in vision does not breathe. That's specified very clearly in the Bible in Daniel 10, verse 17. That is one, only one, of the tests of a true prophet. Number two, if there is a prophet must speak according to the law and the testimony of other prophets, the former prophets. That's Isaiah 8, 19, and 20. Number three, and this is the only test that we're going to look at tonight. Number three, Jeremiah 28, 9, when a prophet speaks and the thing that he predicts or she predicts comes to pass, then you can know that the Lord has sent him, Jeremiah said. That's test number three. Test number four, Jesus said that the work of a true prophet will bear good fruit. He said this is an infallible test. A rotten tree can't bring forth good fruit, and a good tree can't bring forth rotten fruit. That takes a little bit of time to investigate, but that is a valid test. It's an infallible test according to Jesus, Matthew 7, 15 to 20. And the last test of all, 1 John 4, 1 to 3, John says, test, don't believe every spirit, but test the spirits, whether they are of God. And then he says, every spirit that confesses that Jesus has come in the flesh is of God. And a spirit that does not confess that Jesus has come in the flesh is not of God, but this is the spirit of Antichrist. Very interesting description there in 1 John 4, 1 to 3. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus has come in the flesh is of God. Coming in the flesh, of course, is a technical term. The New Testament, what that means, you can discover by reading Romans 8 or Galatians 5. A true prophet will not be mixed up about the nature of Christ. Now, before we get into our subject, let me just state as clearly and simply as I know how the difference between God's remnant people in the last days and the rest of the world. And remember, Jesus said it was going to be like it would be in the days of Noah. And in the days of Noah, the whole world was deceived, but Noah and his family were undeceived, and they thought he was crazy. They said, how can one man be right and the whole world be wrong? It's going to be that way again. It's going to just be a handful of people in comparison with the world population who know the truth. The world, we looked at this last night, the whole world is going to be taken in by these apparitions. That's clear in Bible prophecy. We looked at it last night. It's clear in the spirit of prophecy. It's clear if you just look at what's happening. The world is in the process of being deceived right in front of our eyes. The difference between the world at large that will be deceived and God's people is the world will make their decision on the basis of these miracles that they see these spirits perform. And remember, the spirits are going to perform genuine miracles. It's not just going to be sleight of hand. It's going to be genuine miracles that will be performed by these spirits. God's people will not find their safety or their confidence in the working of any kind of miracles or signs. Their confidence will be in the spirit of prophecy. This is the New Testament. This is the spirit of prophecy. This is inspired by the Holy Spirit. This is the Old Testament. This is the spirit of prophecy. This was inspired by the Holy Spirit. I don't have any Ellen White books with me, but the Ellen White books are the spirit of prophecy because they're inspired by the Holy Spirit. The spirit of prophecy is what's inspired by the Holy Spirit. God's people will have their confidence not in miracles or signs or wonders or anything like that. Their confidence will be in the spirit of prophecy. And my dear friend, if your confidence is not in the spirit of prophecy, if you've lost confidence in that, you are going to be deceived. That is 100% sure. There will be no exceptions. What did I just read? If it were not for the interposition of God, how many of the sons and daughters of Adam would be taken into the devil's net? How many? There wouldn't be one left. Your only chance is if God intervenes. But how is God going to intervene? He intervenes by sending you the message of a prophet. I'm always afraid of running out of time. I have many texts written down here to show how it was in time past. Before the first coming of Christ, God sent a special messenger. You can read about it in the first chapter of John. It says, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came to bear testimony to the truth, that all men to the light, that all men through him might believe. And the people that believed found the Messiah. The people that didn't believe didn't find the Messiah, and the whole Jewish nation was lost because the leaders of the Jewish nation did not accept John the Baptist's testimony. I just must read a couple of texts. Turn your Bible to Matthew 23. Matthew 23. Jesus is speaking. We'll pick it up right in the middle of the paragraph. Verse 34, Matthew 23. On account of this, behold, I am sending to you prophets and wise men and scribes, and some of them you shall kill and crucify, and some of them you shall scourge in your synagogues and persecute them from city to city, that upon you may come all the righteous blood shed upon the earth, from the blood of righteous Abel unto the blood of Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, whom you killed between the temple and the altar. Truly I say unto you, all these things shall come upon this generation. Notice here, it is a very serious thing to reject a messenger that God sends you. How serious is it? Jesus said, I'm going to send you prophets. Speaking to the Jews. I'm going to send you prophets and wise men and scribes, and you're going to kill some of them, and you're going to crucify some of them, you're going to scourge some of them, and the result of that is going to be what? In the judgment, you are all the righteous blood shed upon the earth is going to be laid at your door. I want to tell you, friend, it's very, very serious to reject a messenger that God sends. It's very serious. God will not work a miracle to keep you from being deceived by the devil if you do not accept a messenger that he sends to you. Well, somebody says, well, I need to know, I need to have the evidence of the messenger. Well, of course, that's what we're going to go over right now. We believe, as Adventists, that God has already sent to us a messenger. We do not ever suggest to anyone that they believe that Ellen White is a special messenger sent from God to his remnant people if they haven't had an opportunity to look at the evidence. God always sends enough evidence so you can tell that this is really a messenger from him. If it's a messenger from God, God will send you enough evidence so that you can know that this is a messenger from God. Now, if you don't accept the evidence that God sends, Ellen White says that God will never force anybody to believe. If you want to doubt, there'll always be a hook for you to hang your doubt on. God will never put you in a corner and just make you believe. But if you are a candid searcher for truth, and if you say, Lord, I want to know the truth, it's been one of the most amazing experiences of my life. I've had this happen over and over again. Met people that knew nothing about the truth. And somehow, in their mind, they got to thinking and they just cried out to the Lord, if there even was a Lord. They didn't know God. They wanted, is there a God? Is there a truth? And if there is, can I find it? And I've had them tell me how God led them one step after another, and they found the truth. God always gives enough evidence so that you will know that this is a messenger from him if you want to know the truth. But if you don't want to know, God won't give you so much that you're forced to believe. God expects you and me to make our decision based on the weight of evidence. Now, the weight of evidence is so great that I could never give you all the evidences if I preached from now on till as long as I lived. On just the subject of the spirit of prophecy, I could never give you all the evidences. There's too many evidences. If you want to have more evidences, you can get more. I can get you material so you can check. There's a lot of evidence that you couldn't find unless you wanted to do years of study in theology, if you do years of study in theology and start comparing biblical theology with the Ellen White books, you will be astonished. I'll give you one quick example. One of the topics of great theological controversy among Adventists for many, many years, and also among some other Protestant churches, has to do with the nature of Christ. All manner of controversy. But if you want to do something interesting, if you study all the Ellen White statements that you can find about the nature of Christ, you will be astonished. How could anyone with the educational background of Ellen White say all the things about this subject under all different kind of contexts and never contradict herself? It is astonishing. And I've talked to other people who have studied theology about subjects like that. That's not the only subject in which you find astonishing revelations if you check all the references. But I want to study just one evidence with you tonight. It's so important. We need to review the evidences that God has given us, that we have a special messenger, and we need to check these writings, and we can depend on these writings as we go into the end times. In fact, if we don't depend on them, I believe, friend, that you're going to be taken in by these apparitions that we talked about last night. I believe the only security for any person is if they have confidence in the spirit of prophecy. That's why God gave us this, because he knew we were going into the most deceptive time of world history. Jeremiah said, when a prophet speaks and what he or she says comes to pass, then you'll know the Lord has said it. And by the way, we're not going into this tonight. We'll study this a little bit more tomorrow night when we study the question that some people have had, well, how could a woman be a prophet? We'll study that a little bit more tomorrow if the Lord wills. But I want to simply look at some evidence. Remember, God expects you and me to make our decision on the basis of the weight of evidence. Toward the end of 1874, an epidemic swept through Battle Creek, and one of the people that got sick was Ellen White. Ellen White was never a physically strong person. After she had the accident when she was about 9 years of age, she was physically weak and physically sickly. She became ill with influenza, very severe influenza, and other people got better after a few days, but she didn't get better. Physician came, and the physician said, this is very serious. This could turn into pneumonia. And so James White did what he had done on other occasions when she had become ill. He went and he got Elder Uriah Smith and Elder J.H. Wagner, and Ellen White was brought down from the upstairs of their home, downstairs, and James White and these two other ministers gathered around Ellen White in the parlor, and they anointed her, and they had prayer for her that the Lord would heal her if it was his will. And after they had prayed, Ellen White tried to pray. She could hardly pray. She was so hoarse, she could hardly even talk. But as she was trying to pray, all of a sudden, her voice came out clear and strong and ringing like a bell, and she said, glory to God. And they looked, and James White knew right away that she was in vision. They stayed there and waited. And when she was in vision, of course, she wasn't breathing. She had her hands over her chest like this, folded. And pretty soon, when a prophet's in vision, by the way, you can't control what they do. You can't control what they do. They have superhuman strength. That was demonstrated in Ellen White's life several times. They didn't try to control her movements when she was in vision. Pretty soon she threw the covers off, and she got up, and she started to walk back and forth across the floor, and she said, it's dark. It's dark. And she was wringing her hands. And then she said, well, there's a little light. And then she said, there's more light. And then she said, there's much light. And after a while, she went and she laid down again. When she came out of vision, she, as was common, she took three very deep breaths. She opened her eyes, looked around. James White said, you've been in vision. She said, yes, I've been in vision. James White said, were you shown many things? She said, I was shown many things. She said, James White said to her, would you like to tell them to us now? She said, no, not now. So she was taken back up to her room, and there was a big meeting going to be held that night. People were coming into Battle Creek from various parts of the country. James White went to his office to greet some people, and then he came back home just before the meeting, and he found that Ellen was dressed, and the Lord had miraculously healed her, and she said, I'm ready to go to meeting. She went to the meeting, and she spoke about 20 minutes that night, and when she was speaking, she spoke about the duties that we had. At that time, we only had one foreign missionary, and she said, God wants us to make much broader plans. We need to be sending many more missionaries than just one or two or three. That was that evening, and then the next day, she spoke at this meeting they were having. She spoke about 45 minutes. She said, we need to take much broader views regarding the work which God has given us to do, and then we have a necessity of laying broader plans for the education of home and foreign workers. Our movements in sending workers to foreign fields are altogether too slow. She said that she had been shown in vision companies she had seen in different parts of the world, studying the Bible, and there finding the promise of Christ's soon return to redeem his people, and also becoming convicted that they should keep the seventh-day Sabbath. And she said there are little companies here and there around the world that are finding this out. They don't even know that there are any other Sabbath keepers in the world. And we need to send experienced ministers to these people to help them find all the truth. And if we don't do it, disagreements will arise among them and many of them will lose their way. Not only that, she stated that she was shown in vision that publishing houses were going to be established in different countries and were going to print the truth of the three angels' messages in different languages. And she said, I saw some of those presses and those publishing houses in vision, and if I should see them again, I would recognize them. And James White said, well, did you see the countries where these were? She says, well, I don't remember countries, except she said, I remember the angel mentioning Australia. We didn't have any work at all in Australia at that time. That was in January of 1875. Now, not long after that meeting, Elder W.C. White says, we learned of some groups of Sabbath keepers in Germany. The largest companies were in Volwinkel and Elberfeld. And after hearing about them, they heard about several other companies. Then they heard about companies in Africa and sections of Asia, small companies that had begun to keep the Sabbath just from studying the Bible. And Adventists sent some ministers to these companies. They found out that already they were having troubles with fanaticism, heresies arising among them. And it was providential that we had Adventist ministers that we were able to send to some of these small Sabbath-keeping groups. Now that was in 1875, and it was 10 years later when Ellen White went to Europe with her son. And when she was in Europe, they arrived, this would be 10 or 11 years after this vision, they arrived in Basel, Switzerland. And in Basel, Switzerland at that time, they had just established a publishing house. And when Ellen White was taken to this publishing house, she was taken to the part of the building where the printing business was located. And when she came into the room where the press was, she said, well, I've seen that press before. And then they were going to introduce to her the workers that were using this printing press. And so there were two young men there, and they introduced them to Ellen White. She greeted them. And then Ellen White said, well, she had never seen these people before. She said, well, where's your other worker? Now, nobody had told her they had another worker. They just introduced her to the two that were there. She said, well, where's the other one? She says, I have a special message for him. They said, well, the other one is an older man. He's the foreman of the shop, and he's downtown on business this morning. We didn't know that you wanted to see him. And she said, well, the Lord has given me a special message for that worker. Interestingly, she had not seen any of those people, but when she came into the press, she knew how many people were working there, and she knew which one that she had a special message for. She'd received in a vision 10 years before. That was the first time that she was taken into a room, and she knew exactly who she needed to talk to. because she'd had a vision about it 10 years before. She said, if I ever saw those places, I would remember them. Then she was taken to another place. She was taken to Christiania, Norway. There we had just established a press too. When she was taken into this room where the press room was, she said, well, I've seen these presses before too. This is one of the places shown me years ago where publications were to be issued in countries outside of the United States. That was in 1886. In 1891, Ellen White went to Australia, and she went to Melbourne, Australia, in the first week of 1892, and she was taken to the publishing house in North Fitzroy. And when she came there, she began telling them about the building, all the different rooms and the parts, as though she had been all through it. And when she entered the press room, she said, I've seen all these presses before, and I have a message for the people that work here. I have been shown that in this place, there is not a spirit of unity and harmony, and I want to meet all the people working at this press. What she declared, they found out, was exactly the case. That was an instance where in one vision she said, if I ever saw those things again, I would recognize it, and it was proved that when she said she would recognize it, she did recognize it. That is one vision. Here's another vision that she had in about 1890. Again, this time, she got sick. She got sick a great deal. She was sick a great deal during her life, if you've read her life story. She had caught a severe cold, and she had a sore throat and was hoarse, and she had been doing a lot of visiting and trying to help some people. Their lady had just visited her, whose husband was opposing her for keeping the Sabbath. And so she was so tired, she decided in the evening she was just going to go upstairs to her room and go to sleep. When she got upstairs, she began to pray, and as she did, she said that it smelled the whole room. It smelled like the fragrance of roses, and she started to look around, and she said, here's what she said, looking up to see whence the fragrance came, I saw the room flooded with a soft, silvery light, and she said, instantly, my pain and weariness disappeared, and she said, then, losing all consciousness regarding my surroundings, I was shown in vision many things relating to the progress of the cause in different parts of the world and the conditions which were helping or hindering the work. Among many other things that were shown to her at this time were conditions existing in Battle Creek. And in a very full and striking manner, these were laid out before her. Well, the next day, she wanted to tell her son and also A.T. Robinson, who is with her son, about this vision. And so here's what happened. She proposed to tell the brethren what had been shown her regarding the work in Battle Creek. And immediately after she said that she wanted to tell them this, it seemed that her mind changed and she started talking about something else. And after Elder W.C. White and Elder A.T. Robinson had left, Elder Robinson said to Elder White, did you notice that your mother said she wanted to tell us about this vision, and then she immediately started talking about something else and forgot about it and didn't get to it? And Elder White said, yes, I noticed that very thing. So, then again, she was giving a sermon, and this sermon was a few months later, after this, the vision was in November, this sermon was in March, and during this sermon, she made an appeal that Adventists were to hold forth the distinctive features of their faith, and three different times during this sermon, she said, a scene was presented before me at the Salamanca meeting that I wish to relate. Three times, she said, I want to tell you about this vision that I had at Salamanca. And every time after she said, I want to tell you this, she would start talking about something else, and her mind would seem to be confused, and she couldn't call it to mind. Finally, the third time, she said this. She said, I will have more to say about that at another time. And people, Elder White was, and others, thought, what is this? She tries to tell us this, and then she doesn't. Now, that night, there was a special meeting. There was a special meeting of those who were publishing what was the Sentinel magazine, which was a forerunner of our Religious Liberty magazine. And with the Religious Liberty Department of the General Conference. And these two groups met in meeting, and they had a very severe difference of opinion. And the severe difference of opinion was simply this. There was one party that claimed that such subjects as the Sabbath question, the signs of the times, the state of the dead, and other prominent features of our faith should be eliminated from the paper. That's the Religious Liberty paper. Because this would tend to prejudice the minds of influential men of state to whom the paper was being sent. But there was another party. The other party, the opponent, said this. Their opinion was that the mission of the Sentinel was to proclaim the message in all its phases. This meeting continued until after midnight. They were arguing their positions back and forth. The people that evidently had the most votes were the people that said, we want to take out of the magazine all this material about the Seventh-day Sabbath and the state of the dead and all these things that are peculiar to Seventh-day Adventists, and we want to appeal to a broader listening audience. And so this is what was voted. It was voted to drop the American Sentinel as the organ of the Religious Liberty Association and start a new paper unless the American Sentinel would modify its attitude. They got out after midnight. They went home to sleep about 1 o'clock in the morning. About 5:20 that morning, they were going to an early morning meeting. They had earlier morning meetings than we do. Elder White was on the way to the meeting, and as I was on the way to the meeting, he noticed that there was a light on in his mother's room. He was concerned about her health, and so he said, I must go and check on her. And so he went up and knocked on the door and came to her room and he said, is everything all right? And he saw that she was sitting down writing fast as she could go. He said, well, do you have a message that you want to present to the people? And she said, indeed I do. And so she came down to this early morning meeting with a whole stack of manuscripts. And this is what she told them. She said, at 3 o'clock this morning, an angel woke me up. And the angel told me that I was to present before you the warnings that I had been shown in Salamanca. That was 4 months before. And then she started to tell them what she had been told in Salamanca. She said warnings were given to her that she was commanded to present to men in responsible positions. She said, especially in Battle Creek, great peril surrounded the work, but men knew it not because impenitence blinded their eyes. With regard to one occasion, her guide said, follow me. And she was ushered into a council meeting where men were advocating their views and plans with great zeal and earnestness, but not according to knowledge. One brother stood before the council with a paper in his hand and criticized the character of its contents. The paper was the American Sentinel. Pointing to certain articles, he said, this must come out and that must be changed. If the Sentinel did not contain such articles as this, we could use it. The articles pointed out as objectionable were upon the Sabbath and the second coming of Christ. With clearness, Mrs. White spoke of the views and attitude of the chief speakers in this council meeting. She referred to the harsh spirit manifested by some and to the wrong positions taken by others. She closed her remarks with a most earnest appeal that all should hold forth the truth in its perfection and that the watchman should give the trumpet a certain sound. Now, when she finished speaking, the president of the General Conference who was there was very bewildered. He did not know what she was talking about because he hadn't been at this special meeting the night before. However, there were people in that room that had been at that meeting the night before. In fact, almost everybody that was in that meeting the night before was there. And pretty soon, after Ellen White quit speaking, in which 4 months before she had been shown the very things that transpired that night, a man arose. And here is what he said. I was in the meeting last night, and I am sorry to say I was on the wrong side. I take this early opportunity to place myself on the right side. And then the president of the National Religious Liberty Association stood up. He said, last night, a number of us met in his room at the review office, and there we discussed the very matters that Ellen White just explained. He said, our deliberations continued until 1 o'clock this morning. I will not undertake to describe the meeting. That is not necessary because the description as given by Mrs. White is correct and more exact than I myself could give it. And then he freely acknowledged that the position he held was not right and that he could now see his error. And then another brother stated, he said, I was in that meeting last night. And the description given of that meeting by Mrs. White was true and correct in every particular. And then others stood up, talking about the variance that they'd had and their arguments that they couldn't agree. And they said that this meeting has been correctly described by Ellen White. Elder Robinson says, one brother arose and said, Sister White, I was the one who arose and made the canvas for the Sentinel. The meeting you have referred to was held in the review office chapel last night. The expression that came over Sister White's face as she turned and said in a tone of puzzled inquiry, last night? Friend, do you see God knows your thoughts before you think them? God knows your feelings before you feel them. God knows your words before you say them. God showed to her all the particulars, what they were going to say, what they were going to do, how they felt, 4 months before they did it. She tried to relay the information 5 or 6 times. The Lord kept her from doing it because it would have looked like it wasn't true. God knows ahead of time. Now, this is just one story, not the only story like this that could be told, but just one story. This is not a private story, just something that just somebody reported to you. We're taught, this is like the miracles of Jesus that were worked out in public with many, many witnesses. My friend, God knows everything about the future. Don't ever think, friend, that God does not know your most private thoughts and feelings. He has them all written down. He even knows your private thoughts and feelings that you're going to have next month or next year. He knows about that, friend. And he's given evidence that he knows, and he's given evidence that this is a special messenger that he sent to his people by giving information that no, even the devil couldn't have given information like this, because the devil can't read people's minds, especially not in advance. This is powerful evidence. Not so powerful that you can't deny it if you don't want to, but it's powerful evidence that God has sent a messenger to his people. Shortly after 1900, Ellen White wrote a letter. If you want to look it up, if you have a CD-ROM, it's letter 50. I forget now what year it is. It seems to me maybe 1906. It's letter 50. It was sent to a Seventh-day Adventist evangelist whose name was Simpson. And in this letter, she made this statement. She said that those who believe that God has sent to his people a message through Ellen White will be kept from the delusions that will come in these last days. You see, friends, as we approach the end of the world, there's only going to be 2 groups of people. One of them is going to be almost the whole world. We looked at that last night. It's going to be almost the whole world. The other group is going to be what the Bible refers to as the remnant, The last people that God has that he says are mine, my people, God's last day Israel. And the great proportion of the world, they will make their decision on the basis of the miracles that they see. And they're going to see a lot of them. The others are not going to make any decision on the basis of miracles. They're going to take their position on the basis of the testimony of the witnesses that God has sent, the special messengers that God has sent to his people in the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. My friend, which side are you going to be on? In closing, I want to read to you from, in the Hebrew Bible, it's right at the end of the Bible. In the English Bible, it's not. It's right at the end of the Old Testament in the Hebrew Bible. The last book in the Old Testament in the Hebrew Bible is 2 Chronicles. If you turn to 2 Chronicles, the 20th chapter. This is an experience that God's people had in ancient times. The devil had stirred up multiple armies of idolaters to come and destroy God's people. That happened many times in the Old Testament. And the Lord's people, you can read the whole story there in 2 Chronicles 20. They didn't know what to do. The king said, he went to the Lord, he said, Lord, this great host, we don't know what to do. They were so far outnumbered, there was no way. And it says that right at that time, if you read the story, it says that right at that time, the Spirit of God came upon one of those people, and he says, I have a message to deliver you from the Lord. This is what you're to do. And so they decided they were just going to do what the Lord told them to do. And when they did what the Lord told them to do, I was just reading this in my Hebrew Bible this afternoon, it says that the Lord set ambushes among their enemies, and what, you know what happened? What happened was their enemies all killed each other off, and they didn't have to fight at all. And you know, my friends, we are approaching the greatest battle of all time. It's a spiritual battle. And many, many Adventists are very perplexed, very nervous. What are we going to do when we get to a time of trouble such as never has been since there was a nation? What are we going to do when we can't buy and sell? What are we going to do when they just throw us all in prison or jail? What are we going to do? Friends, our security is not in anything that we can do. And our security is not in miracles. Our security is following the spirit of prophecy. That is our security, and that is our only security. And my friends, if we will listen, if we will listen to what the Lord has told us, one reference, Ellen White told us, she said, the Lord Jesus will take us, carry us through. The Lord is going to carry us through the time of trouble. We're not going to get through it on our own. Nobody's going to get through it on their own. But the Lord can get you through it. This is what it says here. This is what the king said at this time, 2 Chronicles 20 and verse 20. And it says, and they rose early in the morning, and they went out to the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went out and stood, Jehoshaphat said, listen, Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, believe in Jehovah your God, and you will be established. Believe in his prophets, and you will prosper. Oh, friend, the devil knows this. And so the devil is trying to rob God's children of their security. The devil is trying in every way to attempt to show that God's prophets in some way contradict each other. Have you noticed that? And the God's prophets said something that's not true. You've heard all about that. You'll hear a lot more. Sometimes we have made mistakes, in my opinion. I've done it myself. Sometimes we've made mistakes as Adventist preachers in that we've spent a lot of time trying to show, to disprove these false arguments. And there's nothing wrong with disproving the false arguments. But you need to know the basic evidence. That's what you need to know. And that's what we've tried to look at this evening. The basic evidence that shows you do have a special messenger from the Lord and it would be wise for you to listen. This is where the weight of evidence is. Oh, you're going to be told that she said something that's contrary to something in the Bible. You're going to be told that. Let me tell you this. I told this to the church here in Wichita this last Sabbath. I have studied these Ellen White writings for over 50 years. I've read my entire New Testament through in Greek. I've read the entire Old Testament through in Hebrew. I've compared the Ellen White writings with the Bible for many, many years, for decades. And I can tell you, if you just go on the basis of what the Bible says and not on the basis of what the theologians say, you will find out that the Ellen White writings do not contradict the Bible. In fact, they'll lead you back to Bible truth every time. How are we going to get through the future? How are we going to keep from being deceived? It's not going to be because we're smart. If we are kept at all, it's going to be because God intervenes. And how is He going to intervene? God intervenes by sending to us a message through the Spirit of prophecy. And if we will listen, the big problem in Adventism today is that there's so many people that won't listen. They have all these excuses. Trying to make you don't need to make excuses of the Spirit of prophecy. Put your confidence in it. The weight of evidence is powerful. And if you don't lose your confidence in the special messenger that God has sent to us, and if you will follow it, the Lord will get you through whatever's going to come to you in the future. Check it out for yourself. I can't take the confidence I have and just pour it into your brain. I've studied this for several decades. When I was a young man, I decided I was going to find out for sure what was so and what wasn't so. Let me tell you, I spent many months. I got all the materials when I was at Andrews University, and I spent many months checking out the Spirit of prophecy. My decision was not made in a day or a week or a month. I've spent many months checking it out. Checking the evidence. I've also checked the evidence of the people that say she wasn't a prophet. I've checked the evidence. And I won't go into that. I'll just say that the evidence, the weight of evidence is very powerful that we have been sent a special messenger. And if we will listen, God can get you through any trial or trouble that's going to come to you in the future. Do you believe that? God can get you through it. But if God is going to get you through it, you and I are going to have to listen to directions and not lose confidence. Jesus never commended on belief or doubt. Well, if there's somebody here and you haven't had a chance to check these things out for yourself, I invite you to check it. We have nothing to do in secret. Everything that we preach is in the open, and you can check the evidence, and we invite anybody to check the evidence. We believe that God has sent to us a special messenger, and we don't have anything to be ashamed of. We are thankful to the Lord for this wonderful, wonderful gift. There are many of us who owe all kinds of debts of gratitude to this wonderful gift. There are those right in this room. And the reason that they were saved from ill health was because they found things in this special gift that led them to a different course of life whereby they regained their health. That has happened to many people. I invite you to check it out yourself and say, Lord, help me to become a believer. You must have confidence in the message that God has sent you, enough confidence to obey it if God is going to keep you from being deceived in the times of trouble ahead wherein the whole world will be led astray. Let's pray before closing. Father in heaven, we thank you that in mercy you have sent to us and Elijah prophet. We thank you that you have sent to us a special messenger to bring us back to Bible truth. And you have promised us that you are going to have a people, when Jesus returns, who will have on a garment of character that is without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but is holy and without blemish. And Lord, we know that this can never happen unless we are living in harmony with every word that proceeds out of your mouth. And we pray that as we study, that you will lead each one of us to that truth that we need to understand so that we can be a part of that group that is living by every word that proceeds out of your mouth. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful privilege. And we pray that you will help us to understand everything you're trying to teach us and to be a part of that group that lives by every word that proceeds out of your mouth, and so that Jesus can acknowledge us as his children when he returns. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.